I mean, or have to enter it, or
yeah, exactly. I will. So the
translation. Yeah, just say that.
And that's it, right? Do I say you're in Victoria, the last space?
Yeah.
Do I say you're in university?
Yeah, the only words.
We're now down to speed. I'm only going to run like 6.5, 7. So
I'm going last. Now.
So then it only.
Okay. Are we unmuted then? Okay. Hey, everyone on Zoom. We're going to get started in a couple of minutes. 2 minutes. Okay. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Concordia University's fourth space. We are thrilled to welcome Elastic Spaces and their series titled Thinking Aloud, bringing together a network of artists, curators, scientists, students, and community members to address urgent issues of social justice and environment and the environment. Thank you for joining us for today's event titled Architectures for Immersion. And to help situate you, we are streaming to YouTube live from Forest Space, and we are located on unceded Indigenous lands in Chichage, Montreal. And at Forest Space, we work with our university community to mobilize knowledge by co-creating daily activities that examine research questions and projects in development here across the university. We're running this event as a live stream meeting, and so we welcome your comments and questions via the chat. For those of you in the space, if you'd like to participate, just let us know and we'll get a microphone to you. And with that, it's my pleasure to hand it over to Principal Investigator for Elastic Spaces, Leila Sugir. Leila, thanks.
Thank you and welcome everyone, guests and partners. We're really excited to have this three-day event coming together. The first day is an IMAX day, and I'm handing it over to our technical director for Elastic Spaces, Jorge Zavagno, who will introduce the various panels and activities for the day. Jorge.
Thank you, Leila. So yes, today's day one of the Thinking Aloud Colloquium. It's made up of three events. The first panel, which we have the panelists right here, is Architecture for Immersion. Then we have another panel called IMAX by Artists at 3 p.m., which will also be live stream, and you can come to Forest Space to be present as well. Then at 6:30 p.m., we have an IMAX screening at the Montreal Science Center in the Old Port. There are still tickets available, and everyone's welcome to come. The events of today are brought in partnership with York University, Concordia University, Elastic Spaces, the Transnational IMAX Project. This first panel will include, should I go by person? Sorry, I'm stealing your job. I will now pass it to the moderator so that I don't steal your job. Here, do you have a microphone?
I do.
Perfect, thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here.
My name is Allison Whitney. I'm at Texas Tech University, and I'm delighted to chair this roundtable with my colleagues, Jeanine Marchessault from York University, Monica Gagnon and Chip Lineburner from Concordia, Jessica Mulvog, whose presentation we will watch on video. She's at St. Andrews University in Scotland. And we are joined by Jordan Strom, who is a curator of exhibitions and collections at the Surrey Art Gallery and a PhD student at Simon Fraser. So we are in the early stages of projects researching the history of IMAX cinema with a focus on technologically and architecturally significant theaters. And this project is funded by a Shirk Insight grant. So I will hand it over to Jeanine to introduce the project. And
great. Hello, everybody. So I'm gonna talk about our project, Locating Transnational Collaborations in the Early History of IMAX, 1970 to 1990. And, you know, part of this project grows out of the realization that there is no actual written history of IMAX, a Canadian invention that grew out of Expo 67. Expo 67 had lots of multi-screen experiments, and I was involved for a decade in a research project to study and actually locate the material assets of these multi-screen experiments. I was working with Monica Kim-Gagnon, and the two of us began to think about what the next stage might be of such a history, and it what really was the history of IMAX. So that is our project, and I'll just briefly outline some of the things that we are in the process of studying. So for those of you that don't know, as I said, IMAX is a Canadian invention. It can be listed among the most important innovations in the history of the moving image. Its unique combination of production, exhibition, and architectural systems, its international theatrical network. Now, there are over 1,500 theaters in 80 countries around the world. So it's an incredibly successful system. Its affiliations with both commercial cinemas and educational science museums and fair parks have allowed for 50 years of giant screen filmmaking that I think, it remains to be seen, my colleagues disagree sometimes, but I think that it may define the next generation of cinema experiences. Apart from team member Allison Whitney's PhD dissertation on the history on the invention of IMAX written at the University of Chicago, there is no substantial historical account of IMAX's invention, expansion, and its place in the global cinema culture. So our study is focused on the first two decades, as I was saying, of IMAX's history. And this is where IMAX begins to spread into different cities around the world. So we're examining seven IMAX cinemas strategically selected for their historical, technological, and architectural significance, as well as their prominent roles in redefining film production. So we're looking at the first IMAX cinema, which is it was installed in Osaka, Japan, first introduced to the world by Graham Ferguson and Roman Kreuter as part of the 1970 World Fair. Monica Kim-Gagnon and Chip are, I'm sorry.
Lineburger.
There we go. And Chip, Monica Kim-Gagnon and Chip Lineburger are going to be talking to us about that, the very first IMAX cinema, which is actually doesn't exist anymore. So that is also a challenge, trying to figure out what it was and piece it together. The Cinesphere cinema, which was the first slide, and just that was the first permanent IMAX cinema in Toronto, Canada. And we're investigating how it was set up. It was a multimedia system, an IMAX system in that cinema. You can see, obviously, very inspired by Buckminster Fuller's geodesic dome, but so are a lot of the IMAX architectures. We're going to be, we're looking at Fleet Street Theater in San Diego, which was built in 1973, which Allison's going to talk to us about. We're looking at the Domo Omni in Tijuana, Mexico, La Bola, which is right at the center of the slide, produced in 1982, the Bradford Science Center, and the Kion Emma's Snail Theater in Jakarta, Indonesia, which is being studied, investigated by Oliver Hussein, who's another member of our team. He's our artist in residence, who's going to be speaking about his research on this incredible snail cinema, which you can sort of see bottom middle on the next panel. And finally, La Géode in Paris, which is the mirror sphere cinema, will be discussed by Jessica Malvogue. So cinemas constructed in this period are especially significant because not only is production, distribution, and exhibition controlled by the IMAX Corporation, IMAX producers and technologists were constantly revising cinema designs and updating what the IMAX experience was. So every IMAX cinema is unique. Everyone has a different experience to offer. The size of the screens, the layout of the seating, the design of the seating, design of display areas, et cetera. So, IMAX cinemas really are an artist medium. And so that's why it's a very rich research project. So our four interrelated lines of inquiry are, we're looking at the architecture, we're looking at the different screens. Films were produced specifically for those cinemas, and we're going to be talking to the audiences who saw those early films. We're attentive to how the IMAX experience is negotiated and defined in different national settings, the role that technology plays in a nation-building project, the kinds of films that were produced for those different cinemas in those different places. In order to draw out these differences, we're developing a hybrid creative research approach methodology that combines oral history interviews, archival research, and creative engagements with our research materials, which is why we have an artist in residence working with those materials. We're also planning public screenings of historical IMAX films, which we're trying to find. A lot of those IMAX films are actually at risk of disappearing. So one of our objectives would be to try to preserve those early films and to show those films in their original locations. So we're interested in how the transnational collaboration was established in different countries with each cinema and each projector in the first two decades. The next slide. This is just part of our early research. There was a pamphlet produced for those kinds of collaborations by Althea Douglas and Creighton Douglas. So this was produced in 1987 after over a decade of really going places and talking to people and starting the conversation about how to collaborate. And I just excerpted a few things. This is a long table of contents, but you can see how detailed it is and the kinds of conversations that they wanted to have with collaborators So these are the different things to start the conversation. You know, how are you imagining your IMAX cinema in your city? You know, what kinds of screens, what kind of sound system do you want? And so that's what IMAX wasn't one thing. It was a lot of different things. And here's just a paragraph, you know, to start the conversation. And I think what's so interesting about this paragraph is that, you know, your experience is unique. Every IMAX cinema is unique. And so that is really what makes IMAX quite unique. It is not really a mass medium in the sense that everything is standardized. It's a very complex medium. Now, this pamphlet itself was created by Althea primarily. I think Douglas was the front man who would go to different locations and negotiate and start the conversation. But Althea is a trained archivist who collected all of the material from all of the different cinemas up to 87 and put together this pamphlet. And as we have been doing our research, we began to realize there's a completely untold story of IMAX, which are the women of IMAX, a lot of women working as archivists, as editors, as producers, as filmmakers. And so that's a whole other access, research access that we're in the process of devising. I'm going to show a clip from a film by Jackson Myers, Tony Myers' son. And it was created as a tribute, a tribute to Phyllis Ferguson, who was married to Graham Ferguson, who was a really important producer and IMAX filmmaker. Phyllis is a status member of the Algonquins of Golden Lake First Nation. First got into filmmaking by helping on North of Superior. And she is an incredible person who nobody knows about. And she passed away before Graham did. And Graham asked Jackson to create a kind of portrait of her contributions to IMAX. So we'll just look at the first minute.
In the brand new TV radio communication program of Conn College,
and it happened that we were good friends with the person who was Graham's location manager for North of Superior. Graham and members of the crew were often dropping into our house for a cup of coffee or to say hi or whatever. So Phyllis got to know them because she was at our house. She became involved with the actual making of the film.
Before North of Superior, Phyllis was already on a track, and she was heading somewhere. One morning, I woke up and when her part of it was over, she went on up to Whitehorse and began her career in radio and was very successful up there. She wasn't really afraid to try anything. After she'd worked on a few of these projects in television and in radio, she began to understand what a story needed to reveal itself. She began to want to make those things possible. One of Phyllis's great talents was unlocking people and making them available to the camera. She recorded sound, so I think Graham saw her as a fantastic collaborator. She could get people to relax and speak to her and speak to the camera and be a part of these films that were, you know, difficult to make because the camera was noisy, it had to be across the river or whatever before you could use the sync sound. Chief Dan George, for example.
And that's it. I will pass things over to
in the brand new TV radio.
Okay.
Great, thanks.
I have a mic. Thank you. Hello, everyone. And thank you, Janine. I'm going to speak about OMNIMAX, which is also known as IMAX Dome. So the world's first OMNIMAX theater opened in 1973 at the Reuben H. Fleet Space Theater in San Diego, California. And this theater emerged from new approaches to planetarium exhibition. So while a traditional planetarium has a flat floor with concentric rows of seating around a star projector and a dome over top, in the 1960s, Edward Kreutz and James Crooks proposed a new design for the space age, where there would be a raked floor and a tilted dome, quite literally shifting the position of the spectator from earthbound observer to astronaut suspended in the heavens. In the midst of the planning for this theater, Sandy Fleet, who was Reuben Fleet's son, visited the Ontario Place Cinesphere, where he saw North of Superior. And he was so impressed by this IMAX format that he approached the newly formed multi-screen corporation, which would rename IMAX Corporation, to create a film projection system that could fill the space theater dome with a single image. So the resulting OMNIMAX theater design has the IMAX projector in the middle of the audience seating area in a casing called a doghouse. This allowed the film to be projected from within the dome. In this diagram, you'll notice there's also something labeled projection room with a conventional 70 millimeter projector at the back that was unique to this cinema. The one we're focusing on is the one called IMAX. When the Space Theater opened, it included the OMNIMAX projector, a Starball projector, as well as slide and conventional 70 millimeter. This collection of machines was termed the Space Transit Simulator. Early commentators noted how this system made you feel like you were looking around inside the picture rather than at it. Sensations that would inform IMAX promotional slogans of being in the picture. So early shows at the Space Theater incorporated each of these projection media, with OMNIMAX footage integrated with the star projector shows. And this association of OMNIMAX with the sensibilities of space travel was supported by the mobility of the Starball with a triaxial mount that allowed it to move in any direction, meaning the operator could, in effect, fly the theater like a spacecraft. So promotional material claimed that the theater becomes a spaceship, and also notes that the image extends all the way to the floor, and in their words, eliminating the earthly frame of reference. To further this rhetoric of cinematic space travel, several institutions that built OMNIMAX theaters, including Fleet and also the Museum of Science and Industry in Chicago, they put these cinemas in the spaceflight wing of the institution, so alongside the rockets and the moon landers. So OMNIMAX clearly draws upon these traditions of cinema as virtual travel, but its alignment with the heavy ideological implications of the space race adds another level of complexity to our project when we consider IMAX theaters as expressions of historical and national identities. So this alignment of ideologically loaded technologies is even more pointed when we consider the design needs of OMNIMAX and the way that they placed the projection technology on display. So in this cross section, you'll notice that the projection room, which is marked L here, it's a large space under the dome. And it soon became standard practice for the exterior walls of that projection room to be made of glass. And then they would configure the audience lining up area so that everyone would, in effect, watch the projector before they watch the movie. And in many ways, these glass walls were not unlike the display vitrines that you would see for the adjacent displays in the museum, often of space technology. And indeed, the IMAX projectors would have interpretive signage with information about the machines. So consider these directions on projection room lighting from the 1987 edition of IMAX Design Facts. This is a manual outlining the technical and branding standards for IMAX facilities. But this is another document by Althea Douglas. What's notable here is that the guidelines emphasize the aesthetic impact of the projector display and suggest strategic use of spotlights to direct viewer attention to the correct parts of the apparatus, i.e. the equipment itself more than the working areas around it. This is especially notable as it points to a larger set of questions about audience consciousness of IMAX technology, both before and during screenings, which in turn complicates rhetorics of immersion that are so integral to the medium. And when I say that OMNIMAX in particular draws attention to its apparatus, consider how in the mid-1980s, when they began to plan the Cineplus facility at what was then called the Canadian Museum of Civilization, they envisioned a dual screen convertible IMAX and OMNIMAX theater, where not only is there a glass wall on the projection booth, but the transfer from one screen to another, with the dome descending over the audience, was meant to be part of the show. So in effect, the cinema would assemble itself around the viewer as a prelude to the movie. So in this picture, taken inside that theater, you can see the dome in its retracted position, sort of up and behind the audience. And so when it was in this position, you would be watching one of the sort of conventional IMAX films, and then they could move back and forth. As Janine mentioned, about Althea Douglas. So she was a technical writer at IMAX. And as we've been working through her papers, which are housed at the Ingenium in Ottawa, I'm noticing that the manuals for both filmmakers and projectionists speak to evolving and often conflicting philosophies about the kind of experience that IMAX and or OMNIMAX was hoping to cultivate. So Althea's points about projection booth lighting are interesting in themselves, but they're particularly relevant to our project, considering how the contemporary thinking on what constituted the IMAX experience might inform theater design and filmmaking practices, and also how the specific cultural context might coincide with or conflict with those ideas. So that while the need for brand differentiation and also the World's Fair heritage of IMAX mean that reminders of the unique properties of the medium are a factor in any IMAX facility, OMNIMAX is proving particularly compelling on this front because it's because of its spatial peculiarities, the visibility of its technology, and the way those technologies were so often integrated into museums and other cultural sites. And that requires us to think carefully about these discourses of technology in transnational contexts. So now I shall hand it over to my colleagues, Monica and Chip, who will speak about the Fuji Pavilion.
Yes. Are we okay with Allison doing the slide change?
Yep.
Okay, great. Okay, thank you. Well, thanks very much. Thanks to Leela and Thinking Aloud for the invitation to participate in this Elastic Spaces event. And for those of you that came from afar, some of you are here from BC, so welcome to Montreal. So it's my pleasure to be here. I just wanted to add a couple of comments to Janine's introduction, one of which is about the missing films. Janine and I seem to perpetually be working on films that we can't find and that we're looking for. And the World's Fair is the kind of unique world event in which there doesn't seem to be a singular archive where you can actually just go there and find things. So I did want to just kind of plant a seed and say that one of the missing films that we really, really want to find is Labyrinth 4, which we got to see with Graham Ferguson, and which is apparently in the basement of Ontario Place at this time. So if anyone has any connections or it's a unique film that was assembled based on the original Expo 67 installation. but it was a large format IMAX film that was made based on those elements. And I think it was edited by Roman Kreuter.
Yeah.
So anyway, planting that seed. The other thing that I just wanted to mention also is what continues to astound me and is just the endurance of IMAX as a technological format. Every time I go to any film studies conference or archival film conference at EMEA and see the amazing number of film formats that have circulated for the last 120 years, it's kind of astonishing, as we're going to hear from Jessica Mollvog in a moment as well, that the IMAX format has persisted in spite of the kind of singularity of its architecture that's required for every single theater. As you'll see, you saw some of the kind of crazy formats. And of course, ours, the one that Chip and I are going to be talking about, is a uniquely crazy format that looks somewhere between a kind of alien and an insect. So I'm going to get us started here, and then Chip will be presenting some of our archival research that we've been doing. But so to start, just to let you know that the Fuji Pavilion and the film that was projected inside it, which was entitled Tiger Child, were designed for the Osaka 1970 World Exhibition by the Fuji Group, a consortium of 38 companies in Japan. The architecture was a spectacular pneumatic inflatable structure by Japanese architect Yutaka Murata, and it was engineered by a company called Kawaguchi and Engineers. The structure itself was composed of 16 air inflated arches that were assembled together, providing an entrance and an exit at each end. And Chip is going to provide some detail of the interior of the pavilion. So this theatrical world exhibition event is often referred to as the first IMAX film. This initial research on the Fuji Pavilion, I want to add, is drawing on my colleague Allison Whitney's doctoral thesis, The Eye of Daedalus, A History and Theory of IMAX Cinema, as well as her MA thesis on Labyrinth at Expo 67. This research also draws on Seth Feldman's chapter on the film Tiger Child in the anthology Cinephemera that's edited by our colleagues Zoe Druick and Gerda Kammer, as well as the chapter entitled Son of Labyrinth in Brian Nolan's 2004 book on Donald, which is entitled Donald Britton, Man of Film. Chip has been doing some amazing research, in particular in the Japanese archival materials that we can find online, as well as in other design magazines. And one thing I just wanted to mention that Chip surprised me at one point earlier in the summer when we started working together. He said, I've actually been studying Japanese for about the last, I can't remember for how long. And I've been able to just decipher quite a few of the archival materials in the Japanese archives. So that was an added plus that I didn't know about when Chip and I first started working together. That's a good one. Okay. I'm sorry, you can change to this slide. Is it going automatically?
No. I'm just trying to discern what.
Okay, this slide is good.
Okay.
So on one side, protruding outwards was the projection booth that housed the enormous projector. And this projected onto a large 43 by 62 foot screen, 13 by 19 meters, totaling 2,700 square feet of screen space at the other end of the pavilion's interior. In the center of the pneumatic structure were other projections referred to as the mandala. And I say it's referred to as the mandala because any literature that we've come across in the archive or any of the reviews of this particular pavilion say the mandala. This was assembled by Teiji Ito, who just incidentally, for film buffs out there, was formerly married to Ukrainian-American experimental filmmaker Maya Darren until her death. So viewers stepped onto a rotating turntable that you can see here, and they looked up at the mandala projections, as well as over to Tiger Child's enormous multi-frame compositions, which alternated between 9 frames and variations of this. I think we can probably switch slides. Oh, actually, you can just see the tip of the 9 screen version, but this is the interior. Okay. There was also a cruciform formation that was composed of 5 frames. There was 3 vertical columns, each comprised of 3 frames, and a single giant full frame IMAX image as well. So you can see that it alternated between these kind of 9 projector formats. And here you have the kind of the three column version. So the film that was presented in the pavilion was Tiger Child, and it was directed by NFB veteran Donald Britton. And it was produced by filmmakers Roman Kreuter of the NFB with Graham Ferguson and Robert Kerr, all of whom had contributed to Expo 67's spectacular multi-screen films, respectively Labyrinth and Polar Life. Preliminary plans and archival materials at the Library and Archives Canada in Ottawa show that the National Film Board's Colin Lowe, who had also worked centrally on Expo 67's Labyrinth, contributed on the art direction for the mandala in particular, but in relationship to the film. Based on their film experiments and their experiences at Expo 67, Kreuter and Ferguson formed the Multiscreen Corporation Limited in 1967. And this would be the seeds of what would become IMAX. And they were hired by the Fuji Group to undertake the making of Osaka Fuji Pavilion's film shortly after Expo 67. Because our really compressed time today, our focus today is going to be on the interior of the mandala and some of the archival research that Chip in particular has been undertaking. And the mandala has shown itself to be far more elaborate than previous accounts have suggested that we've come across. So now I'm going to pass it over to Chip.
Thank you, Monica. In our approach to studying the Fuji Group Pavilion, my role has largely been one of sifting through contemporary sources to glean what we can about the intent of the designers prior to the pavilion's opening, as well as the qualities of the pavilion and its constituent media as finally presented. The first aspect I'd like to address is that of the building itself. The image being shown is one of the earliest architectural models that we have found evidence of. This photo, along with several others, dates from about 1968 in an issue of the Italian architecture magazine Domus, and shows a model that differs from the eventual design in several striking ways. First, it consists of far more inflated tubes than the later design 16. Furthermore, the interior shows three raised platforms connected by bridges, no turntable, and most importantly, no signs of a film display of any kind. Though the history of this model remains unclear to us, it's entirely possible it dates from earlier in 1967, prior to the involvement of the IMAX players, who were contacted following their involvement in the 1967 Montreal Expo. The next model I would like to show has some clearer details. Though this photo is from a sort of press release made by the Fuji Group, its architectural plans are also included in the previously mentioned Domus article, and show a double loop spiral moving walkway ending in an escalator to the lower floor with a quite striking inclusion of three separate screens along the periphery. These triplicate screens were no doubt the motivation for the turntable, allowing patrons to view all three screens without moving themselves. And thus this model goes a long way to explaining why the final design might include a turntable for a single continuously visible screen. The final architectural drawing here illustrates the pavilion more or less as it was eventually built, with the spiral walkway reduced to a circular turntable and the three screens reduced to just one. However, with the main screens reduced, we also find the introduction of Teiji Ito's mandala slide projections, effectively creating a full dome projection on the ceiling of the pavilion. Prior publications mentioned by Monica have remarked that the slides of these projections have been lost, but I would now like to address these as our archival work has been able to make great strides in recovering what these images actually looked like. First, we were very lucky when our colleague Allison recently found a number of documents at Library and Archives Canada in the Colin Lowe fond that describe both the slides through Colin Lowe's notes and the machines to project them in a Japanese language technical document. What we've learned from these documents and others is that the slides were projected using 28 custom-built projectors, likely a collaboration of Sunrise Co., which still works in movie theater pre-show advertising, Canon of photography fame, and the Kureha Chemical Company engineering a special coolant system for these enormous xenon lamp projectors. The latter of these two companies, notably, were also members of the Fuji Group itself. Interestingly, though the slideshow, as it was called, was indeed produced from and appears as slides, Their technical implementation appears to have been as a long, continuous loop of film capable of sustaining the constant usage throughout the fair's run. The design of the slides themselves, though created by Teiji Ito, can be found briefly described in two separate iterations of a script authored by Colin Lowe. While these outlines are vague in their descriptions, they give us a clear idea of how the slide designs were planned to correspond to the IMAX film shown on the main screen. Now, this in and of itself is not nearly enough to reconstruct the experience in the Fuji Group Pavilion. However, by digging into contemporary magazine articles, press announcements, documentaries, archival photographs, and souvenir guides, we're slowly but surely recovering how these slides actually looked. They range from collages to cohesive images and abstract patterns to concrete subjects. The images being shown are just a sample of what we found, and between the notes of Colin Lowe and the fact that the main screen showing the IMAX film Tiger Child is visible in many of these shots, we're confident that we'll be able to, if not recover the original slides, reconstruct a reasonable facsimile. Indeed, one of the photos we've been able to retrieve even captures a slide transition, showing two sets of images superimposed and strongly suggesting these sets must have been adjacent in the original script. The final aspect of the pavilion that I'd like to address is the oft-overlooked incidental sensory dimension. In finding attendee photo journals of the fair, we've been able to draw further conclusions about the experience of visiting the Fuji Group Pavilion. These sources outline elements such as the feeling of touching the pavilion's inflatable tubes themselves, the smell they produce, and background noises during the show that create a much richer sense of place for the pavilion. To this last point about noise, we've not only found a textual reference to the sound the slide projectors made, but in fact discovered a recording of their sound within a documentary segment on the pavilion. And I should have that sound here.
Let's see if it'll play.
So that sort of clattering noise on top of the audio, or on top of the music rather, is the sound that those projectors made. So with all these insights in hand, we have thus been able to proceed with building a digital reconstruction of the Fuji Group Pavilion and its constituent media. And I just have a clip here of what we're working on. Yeah, you got a second to prep the...
Yeah, it's okay.
Oh yeah, that was Gordon Lightfoot in that.
Okay.
Oh, okay. So this very slow video clip being shown is a preliminary build of our digital model standing on the turntable at the far side from the main screen. While our current model only blocks out main architecture, screen, and dome projection, our goal is to integrate the actual Tiger Child film itself, along with a reconstruction of the mandala slides, into a fully immersive VR experience. By reconstructing the pavilion in a dynamic, explorable fashion, we hope to illustrate the complex and particular nature of this site, not only as an early example of IMAX film technology, but as the original designers called it, a total experience. Now let's back to, are we on to Jordan now or Jessica?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks. So now we're going to have a pre-recorded video from our colleague, Jessica Mulvog. And she will be speaking about the Géode cinema in Paris. And the, over to her.
Hello, my name is Jessica Malvogue. I'm sorry I couldn't be there in person today. So for the IMAX project, I've been doing a bit of research on La Géode, which is an OMNIMAX cinema in Paris, France that opened in 1985. One of the most striking things about La Géode is its architecture, as you can see, and it's made me think about the use of spherical structures and screen experiences. So the sphere has become a kind of signature for IMAX cinemas around the world. So I want to think today briefly kind of about this shape, its history in terms of screen architectures, and consider its role in immersion. So La Géode is part of a massive science and technology museum complex situated in northeastern Paris. When it opened in 1985, it was the biggest cinema screen in the world at 26 meters in diameter and the second OMNIMAX cinema in Europe. The building was designed by Adrien Fensilbert, who worked with engineer Gérard Chameilleux. The shell structure is a geodesic sphere made of steel, and the facade is made up of over 6,400 stainless steel triangles that create a mirror effect. And the sphere is placed on a small pool of water, so the effect is of a kind of massive reflective ball. This is a cross-section of La Géode. It differs from Fleet Science Center in that there's no star ball here. So the projector is situated in the center of the auditorium. And you'll see that the screen is distinct from the outer shell. So it's much smaller than the geodesic dome. But you would nonetheless have this experience of entering into this gigantic mirrored dome as the screen inside kind of approximates the outer shell. So like many of his predecessors who also created geodesic architectures for IMAX cinemas, Fensilbert mentions explicitly being inspired by Buckminster Fuller and of course his famous geodesic domes, which you in Montreal know very well. So I'm going to speak a little bit about Fuller spheres because they are very much at the root of the IMAX sphere. And I think we can see a trajectory from kind of Fuller's ideas about the effects of this experience of his geodesic spheres, which leads kind of straight to the heart of IMAX and the immersive experiences of IMAX. So while he isn't directly tied to IMAX, Fuller is nonetheless a very important figure in this history. So the geodesic sphere is based on a set of interlocking triangles. Fuller created his domes in search for a lightweight, affordable, yet strong structure that can enclose a large volume of space within with the least amount of structural weight. So as you can see by this photograph, it's a very, very strong structure. And the geodesic dome is imagined to be put to use in many different ways, from kind of temporary DIY housing to, you know, huge spheres that would help protect cities from kind of oncoming pollution. So Fuller is not, in fact, the inventor of geodesic domes, although he did coin the term geodesic. The Zeiss Planetarium in Jena, Germany is in fact the first large-scale geodesic structure to be made already in 1926. And this kind of deepens this, historically, this relationship between IMAX and planetariums that Alison Whitney has discussed today. But Fuller did kind of popularize this structure in the post-war period, and of course it became a symbol of the kind of utopian zeitgeist of the 60s and 70s. So the Zeiss Planetarium likely influenced what Fuller called his geoscope design, which in an early iteration at Cornell University was a structure that enabled you to view the stars and the Earth from within a geodesic globe. So as you can see here, there is a transparent overlay of the world map onto a geodesic sphere. And inside the sphere, there was a central viewing platform that you would use to view the night sky. The geoscope's poles were oriented to be parallel with the axis of real Earth, and it was rotated such that Ithaca was at the zenith. So as Fuller states, quote, by observing the movements of the sun and the stars against the grid lines relative to the polar constants, the rotation of the Earth could be vividly experienced. So this is something we can't feel in our everyday. We can't feel that we are all on a huge spherical rock floating in space and slowly rotating. And Fuller wanted us to be able to feel this. So he calls this the true planetarium, And the impetus for this design and this feeling that he wanted to provoke was to raise a planetary consciousness, to make people aware of the planetary and their kind of role on planet Earth. So Fuller then built upon this kind of geoscope design to envision a sphere that would be covered with screens. And he calls this the optimum geoscope. The optimum geoscope would be 200 feet in diameter and would feature a 360-degree screens connected to computers. And it was meant to relay historical and real-time data crucial for the workings of the planet. So Fuller talks about this 360-degree screen in different ways, in different writings. Sometimes he likens it to a television screen because it was supposed to be live. But more often than not, it sounds like a kind of prototypical kind of digital data visualization. So the project was never realized. It was far too technologically advanced for its time. But Fuller wrote about it consistently until his death in 1983. So Fuller's whole raison d'être was planetary sustainability. He understood quite early on that the way in which Earth's resources were being used was not sustainable, and that the world was heading for environmental catastrophe. So the geoscope was designed to be a kind of pedagogical tool that would be able to visualize patterns and processes between different human and natural elements in new ways. But the aesthetic, the kind of effective and emotional experiences of being immersed in this sphere were for Fuller crucial companions to the intellectual aspects of this experience. So if we could learn about Earth's processes in ways that were visceral, that made them visible and sensible to the human sensorium, then we'd have more motivation to take this experience and the lessons learned back into the real world. So it's very much akin to kind of discourses of, for instance, VR as an empathy machine, with the crucial difference that VR is an individual experience, and this would be an experience for multiple people to have. So I think this idea of immersion and its pairing with pedagogy, as we see in Fuller's geoscopes design, is very much a part of the IMAX project. IMAX has historically produced nature documentaries that are shown in spectacular architectures of museums and science centers, so places of learning. Fuller's life work wanted to reveal the connections, the patterns between various elements of the universe. And I think this is what really makes the sphere so compelling and forceful. It's a shape that connects us to various scales in the universe, scales we don't normally have access to, from the very large to the very small, as well as in less perfect forms, to scales that we can see and feel. So inside the OMNIMAX cinema, the screen approximates a normal human field of vision. And as probably everyone in the room has experienced, immersion in IMAX is a kind of collective feeling of being inside somehow the picture. So I think in some ways we could consider OMNIMAX cinema, such as La Géode, as partial realizations of Fuller's dream of the optimum geoscope. Insofar as the collective experience of immersion is put to use, in the case of IMAX largely, to explore the natural world, generating the sense of being together and an immersion that makes us feel that we are part of the world on screen. So to conclude, I just want to point out the newest kind of large-scale immersive screen on planet Earth, the Las Vegas Sphere, which doesn't yet appear to have any pedagogical outputs, but I think it's clearly a progeny of this spherical history of IMAX cinema. So thank you very much.
One second. Okay. Thank you to Jessica. Now we'll move on to Jordan Strom, who's going to talk about transitions 3D. Of course.
Hi, everybody. It's great to be here with you all and to learn a lot through those presentations and to be in such fine company. I just would have been really admiring the work of especially Jinin and Monica, their work on Expo 67 and Monica's work as an art critic and theorist in larger ways. So it's an honor to be on the same panel, and I'm looking forward to reading your book in more detail. So I was going to focus a little bit. I don't have detailed diagrams of the particular space per se of the installation of the film that I'm going to speak about today, but I will be talking about the larger structure a little bit more, and I'm looking forward to learning more about some of the architectural qualities of the projection room itself. But so I'll focus on the film Transitions, a film that was presented at the Vancouver World's Fair in 1986, and to the best of my knowledge, has not been presented since. It actually comes out of, I was doing research on Emil Radok's The Taming of the Demons, which is a multi-screen film that it turns out was actually presented a few years later after Expo 86. And I started to get quite interested in Colin Lowe and Ian Ianzalo's film Transitions. But before looking at the elements of the film, I wanted to start by looking at the space itself, the architecture of immersion, as it were. So in her 2008 suite of drawings titled Residual Memories, Andrea Nunes created a series of drawings of buildings, structures, structured cityscapes, street furniture with connections to Vancouver's World's Fair. In her accompanying text, she writes, residual memories conjure now outdated ideas of the future and how we felt when we thought of them and how we yearn to feel that way again. And many of the images are like this one are quite diffuse. Each of the drawings she emphasizes features buildings such as the Expo Center, which is a Buckminster Fuller inspired dome on the edge of False Creek, the BC Pavilion, street furniture, floating McDonald's. That is one of the things that has been most remarked upon around Expo 86 is this McDonald's that floats, strangely. I'm not going to talk about that here. pictured here is a drawing of the Canada Pavilion, what is later rebranded Canada Place. The image is bleached out. The space of the Teflon roof is blocked in as a solid shape, a diluted silhouette floating above a skeletal form. Extending out onto the edge of Cole Harbor, its image evoked the earlier wooden ships that would have docked on piers along that same shoreline. Completed in 1985, the building was a joint venture of Ziedler Roberts Partnerships with Downs Archambault Architects and Planners, along with Moosen, Cattell, and Mackey Partners. And in one recently published survey of Canadian architecture, the author described Canada Place, or then the Canada Pavilion, as a prow thrusting into the Burrard Inlet, a roof line of sails catching the wind and the superstructure of an ocean liner. What once stood tall again, the cruise ships that docked, or which once stood tall against the cruise ships that docked on its edge, nowadays is kind of a diminutive scale compared to the new generation of cruise ships that dock at its pier. A few of the early reviews of Canada Pavilion refer to the architecture critics pick up on this relationship to an earlier building. And Eberhard Ziedler's conceptual designs for the building were inspired in part by Frei Otto's freeform tent structure from the German Pavilion at Expo 67. Though not in the sense of, quote, an artificial landscape without any defined edge, as Tom McDonough has written about in relation to Otto's building in one of the anthologies for the Expo 67 anniversary a few years ago, Ziedler's structure was clearly a more divided up. And the critics have sort of written about this and sort of a different type of space. a framework geared for future trade show usages and conferences. Canada Place, so the fair ran from May 2nd to October 13th, 1986. And the main pavilion was separated from the Canada Place pavilion was separated from the main fairgrounds across the city. And at the time, the Canada Pavilion was hyped as the largest pavilion ever created for a world exposition, which I don't have any, I doubt, you know, kind of marketing hyperbole, but this was the one of the people involved in it. But I have not actually found I highly doubt it. When I look at the history of world expositions and some of the enormous buildings, I think that's more promotional, but I'll get back to you on that one. So John Crimpton, the producer of cultural programs for the pavilion, referred to it as a mini expo on its own site. The Canada Pavilion was remarkable for its extensive variety of exhibitions featured under its elongated structure. There were several theaters, exhibition halls, large and small, and an outdoor amphitheater. Five of the theaters show films, three of them forming a sequential introduction to the pavilion, and the other two providing feature-length productions, one of which is the Transitions film. The creative director of the pavilion, Norman Hay, someone who you may recall was involved in Expo 67, 20 or so years earlier, described the sequence of the pavilions as designed to be like a procession. It was a meta exhibition. It was distinctly linear and proudly epic, and actually inspired, among other things, by whirligigs and folk art, as Hay has described elsewhere. As the five sails architecture made evident, the Canada Pavilion was conceived first and foremost as a voyage, which leads to the question, what kind of voyage? There's this image here of the New Frontiers Theater, just to give you a sense of one of many different rooms. And one of them actually has a revolving theater with a revolving sort of turntable floor as well, but I'm not gonna get into that here. There's a 14 screen circle vision, slide projection space, Earth Watch, a film by Donald Britton, a show scan film, and other aspects. The John Watt video wall, just to give you a sense of how moving image was being presented in all sorts of forms in the Canada Pavilion, is pictured here, just some stills featuring montages of technologies of transportation. Bigger, I think, than the Nam June Paik work concurrent to that in terms of scale. It was a massive sort of project with video disc synchronized technology. The procession of the exhibition hall has come to a head with the CN IMAX cinema that sits at the north end of the building, pictured here in the floor plan. From the outside, the curvilinear dome marks this theater space and breaks with the rhythm of the sail and mast motif. From the inside, the cinema rises up, literally through an ascending ramp, up and out of the procession, forming a sort of crescendo to this larger exhibition. So now just a little bit about Transitions itself. Oh, maybe with this image, I don't know when it was, but it was curious that the IMAX logo was presented out on the front of the building, because I'm not sure who would actually see that other than the cruise ships that come in. So, you don't see it here on the side of the structure for the IMAX theater, but it appeared at some point. And then with the removal of IMAX from the space a number of years ago, I think in 2009, I think it disappeared, but it spoke to the aspect of who was the audience. And a lot of it was geared towards people coming into the harbor as tourists. But certainly, of course, many people were experiencing it from the Metro Vancouver area. So a transition was produced by the National Film Board and IMAX Corporation. It was 20 minutes and 37 seconds in duration. Audience were instructed to use polarized glasses instead of anaglyphic ones. There's a six-track sound system that primarily plays ambient sound with occasional musical sequences. I mentioned this because I'm not going to play any video clips because of time, but Ernest McCabe was the filmmaker's film's director of stereoscopy and cinematography. And it was funded by the Canadian National Railway and Harbor Place Corporation. The film featured a sequence of vignettes, short tableau-like scenes, moments from Canadian and history and imagined scenes as well. The film begins, as scholar David Harris Smith writes, a party of European settlers accompanied by First Nations as guides and seasoned coureurs de bois struggle with their cargo over a canoe portage amidst maple-like maple-lined lakes of the Canadian Shield. I don't have an image of that here, but that scene returns at the end to sort of bookend the larger film. It speaks to the traditions of landscape painting that have sort of formed the narrative of Canada. But a lot of scenes of transportation, for sure. And if we go to the next image, this careening sort of car chase lurches head on into the audience. It's hard to sort of get that from these stills, but if you can sort of imagine, let's suspend, you know, the sort of imagine the sort of 3D stereoscopic experience. I just want to give you a sense of some of the imagery. I'm also quite interested in how extractive economies were being shown in the World's Fair at this time, including logging in a number of the large format films, but also mining and other forms of industry. Here are logging foreman radios to a helicopter operator as a huge cluster of logs plummet into the inlet of Howe Sound. One of the more remarked upon scenes in the film is this teddy bear factory. Lowe describes transitions as an impressionistic, almost surrealistic look at Canadian transportation and communication. Certainly some of these moments, these vignettes capture that. Lowe describes how the film was in part inspired by his interactions with Norman McLaren, who he became friends with and worked with, in particular, the McLaren's Festival of Britain in 1950-51, when he first met him and then saw that he had 3D paintings in his home. And that started a conversation and certainly led to, in some ways, it was sort of a germ of sorts for this work that was in Vancouver. In transitions, writers attended to focus on the technical feat of 3D animated computer. That's okay. The 3D animated computer scene, a lot of writing on this scene, and it's a significant one for sure. It consumed over 1 million feet of magnetic tape, but it wasn't just extraordinary for its technical achievements. But for me, the most interesting aspect of the films were its reformulations of early cinema. Sort of look at contemporary robotics and new technologies, but also this earlier sort of history of world's fairs and technologies of film and moving image. So including the likes of Edward Muybridge's Zupraxis scope that was presented at the Chicago World's Fair in 1893 at the Zupraxographical Hall, to Thomas Edison's early films, or but here the dancing scene, I think, is a bit of a nod to the waltzing couple of the Zupraxiscope, the galloping horse scenes elsewhere. So the film was heavily sponsored by CN Rail, and it also Expo was convened on the anniversary of the first passenger train arriving in the Pacific. So there were many references to film train technologies, including an homage to the Lumière Brothers' 1895 film, L'arrivée d'un train en gare de la Ciotat. And each image is an opportunity to put in Lowe's words, all out there with you, as he sort of referred to this. He wanted to sort of put the image right literally on your lap through the stereoscopic experience. And so just a couple more stills. I can't get into it in detail here, so I'll just touch on it briefly, but I was interested in how this reference to earlier stereoscopy in late 19th, early 20th century World's Fairs, and Jonathan Crary's work in particular, talking about the stereoscope as a kind of complementary model and also rival to the panorama. And it produced, according to Crary, an image which in its hyper-tangibility with all figure and no ground, no periphery, what is lost in both panorama and stereoscope is the possibility not only of classical figure-ground relationships, but also consistent and coherent relationships of distance between image and observer. So in the film Transitions, the filmmakers are bringing together these rival and complementary models of visual consumption of the panorama and the stereoscope, I think in interesting ways. And they're doing it within this sort of new architectonics and frameworks of tourism of the late 20th century. And images of, yeah, there's the image of in Crary's work of the panorama and the stereoscope viewer. And then jumping ahead, just a bit of a nod to the Osaka conversation and the viewfinders, which presented the fair, including one of the slide images was of the Ericsson building at Osaka. And that's in a whole other story, is why Arthur Erickson was not involved in the Vancouver World's Fair, but that's for another time. I'm interested in how transition reactivates a sort of cinema of attractions in this very different moment and with different, very different formats. It's not so much about a sort of shock and fear, but it is related to a kind of sort of collective experience that has been sort of touched on. And you know, the Expo president sort of famously said, or infamously said, you get them on site, you feed them, you make them dizzy, and you scare the shit out of them. And, you know, I think that this certainly with this film, there is this aspect of a kind of induced sort of states of delirium at times, but there's a very different kind of aesthetic approach. And it's much more subtle. It's uncanny. At times it's a bit sort of saccharine and quite twee. I think this is a whole range of aspects to the film. And sometimes it might even be a little bit boring for some viewers, but I think it's trying to enact a certain type of viewership, this reference to earlier cinematic histories. One reviewer said, I would have earned 6 stars if the technique had been used to tell a story. Gave it 5 stars. But it's this demonstrative quality that in sort of my larger research, I'm sort of looking at in relation to other films and art installations around the fairgrounds. But Gunning Lowe was quite interested in Eisenstein's ideas around film and attractions, and certainly was inspired by them and talks about them in his interviews at the time. And so was Gunning, who wrote the essay on a cinema of attractions in 1986, or was published in Wide Angle magazine. Just skip ahead, just around the larger context, is this idea around early sort of proto-cinematic technologies was very kind of rich landscape across the fairgrounds. Was the collaboration between the Omista Kwakwaka'wakw Arts Center, Culture Center in Alert Bay with Bob Rogers, a kind of magic lantern projected image, and then other works that were off-site, such as Rodney Graham's conceptual model for a kind of tower slash cinema device, which I'm not going to get into here. And then down the highway in Surrey Art Gallery, where I work, was in 1986, right at the opening of the fair, was Stan Douglas's Overture, an installation that resituated a clip of a film, a short sequence from a panoramic view of Kicking Horse Canyon in southeastern BC, along with a recitation of a fragment of Marcel Proust's Remembrance of Things Past. So I think for me, Lowe and Ianzolo's film can benefit from close comparative readings across a broader field of practice in the mid-80s media culture, in addition to thinking of it in relation to IMAX histories and World's Fair histories of moving, projected moving image. And in this way, I think, same with Stan Douglas's work and other artists who were producing work in Canada at the time, to think it through this sort of major spectacle that was going on in the mid-1980s. And he's produced other interesting work of that time that I think should be read against this context and not lifted out and placed in art history or cinematic history in a kind of petri dish. So to conclude, I want to briefly turn to the space in which transition is connected. This is just the adjoining room. If you were there, you might recall this is the Great Hall. This, I think, it's about 5,000 square meter hall, anchored in the middle with a Haida canoe and a floating dirigible, which was supposed to be used for helicopter logging, and I don't believe it was ever, aerial logging, but it was never, I think, fully realized. So also we need to look at this sort of, and here I'm kind of, showing my curatorial hat, I guess, is to think about this film transitions in relation to the larger exhibition. So while there's a need to look at the 5-story high screen, the 40 speakers, the seating arrangements in detail, as others have done, I think thinking of it in conversation with the other works, many of them were mechanized kind of kinetic sculptures, and I think have an important relationship to the film, but also to, I think we can learn about contemporary virtual and augmented reality productions and artistic works today through looking more carefully at these types of films, and specifically the transitions film. And here you know, the Cyborg Manifesto was written just a year before Expo 86, I believe it was published, and this sort of anxiety of roboticism and technological assisted human hybrids was certainly on display in Vancouver at that time. So I think that's where I want to end, that there are among the foundations of the transitions, they can point a way forward to think of this new immersive media that we are looking and experiencing today and moving image culture more broadly. And I'll just finish with an image I won't speak to, but I think sort of speaks to the sort of gushing, effusive quality of the exhibition of the Canada Pavilion and its nationalism and other things that I wasn't able to get to, by Hadley Maxwell. Thank you.
Thank you. But now we have some time for questions, comments, either from the audience or among our panelists, or, and if you have a question, someone will bring a microphone to you so that our, and those of you who are on Zoom, we are happy to hear from you as well. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you so much for these wonderful presentations. I'm wondering, I'm going to ask a question a little bit from left field. I hope that's okay. I wonder if someone on the panel could say a few words about like the state of conservation or conservation issues related to some of the early films from the 60s or 70s, or even the spaces, because I wonder how fragile the films are, as well as the structures in which they're shown. Thank you.
We have a lot of terrifying stories on that front.
I'll start and then pass. It is an issue with IMAX. I mean, we were kind of horrified to find that there were IMAX films in the basement of the Cinesphere. And these were, like, you know, numbers, dozens of films produced by Ontario Place in the 70s have not been preserved. And because Ontario Place is in a state of flux right now, we don't know what is going on. I know at some point Ontario Place did bring in an archivist to look at some of the films and, you know, give a report on what they needed. And then I've talked to that archivist and he said, and then everything was dropped. So the door was closed. We're working with Paul Gordon at Library and Archives Canada, who's a conservator and very much devoted to large format film. And he is one of the people that alerted us to the extreme fragility of early IMAX films have not been preserved and are at risk of disappearing. Monica mentioned Labyrinth 4, which is an extremely valuable film because it's the only actual documentation of Labyrinth Chamber 1, mm-hmm. produced and edited by Roman Kreuter. We showed that at a festival called In Future at the Cinesphere couple of years ago, and it's in terrible shape, the vinegar syndrome. And apparently IMAX in LA are committed to helping to preserve some of these films. So that's a conversation we're just starting to have, facilitated actually by Monroe Ferguson, who's going to speak on the next panel, but I'll pass it over to you.
Just picking up on that, one of the particular challenges is that we are interested in these films that were created for specific places and often connected to particular events or sort of periods in an institution's history. And as is often an issue with, you know, what we call orphan films, right? When the particular I guess, use value of the film expires, then who knows what happens to it. And so I think all of us have had experiences of being at an IMAX theater and then like someone opens a door and there's a bunch of things in a closet. One of the goals of our project is to hunt down those films and see to it that they are preserved, but it is a challenge. And picking up on that, your point about the venues, right? Since these are films that require specific spaces in which to be viewed, and some of those spaces either shut down or perhaps convert to digital formats and things like that, it becomes, that introduces another level of complexity to viewing this material. So, yeah, if you have another.
Sorry, Zhenyan's just saying that I should mention Tiger Child, and I said, "Well, we don't have Tiger Child." She said, "That's right. We don't. You haven't seen the film Tiger Child. We saw it once at the IMAX theater at Ontario Place, and then you know, it's been that was the fleeting experience of taking notes." And then we haven't been able to locate it since then. I mean, to your question, there could be probably an entire day and an entire panel based on terrifying anecdotal stories of lost films that, you know, we've seen for one instance or we know is somewhere. But as Allison mentioned, the specifics of the projection technology make it impossible to actually see, and they're fragile. I mean, one example is just Earth is Man's Home from Expo 67 that was done by Anne and Nick Chaparros. And I mean, I have multiple anecdotes about that one. There's the positive one, which is that we've been able to work quite closely with the Cinémathèque Québécoise and Stéphanie Côté in particular. And as you probably know, they have kind of three storage vaults. There's the climate controlled one that's on the South Shore in Boucherville. There's the one that they have on site at the Cinémathèque Québécoise. And then there's the warehouse where previously, I think Jean Gagnon, when he was director of collections, would never say no to anything. So there's the warehouse in Mirabel where that's where they would just put everything that they received. And I think World Exhibitions in particular don't necessarily have a specific location for any of the archives. There were screening copies that kind of turned up in different places. Stephanie was able to locate Earth is Man's Home. I can't remember if it was in the vault. I can't remember where it was that she found it, but we were able to team up, and our research, the Expo research team, was able to provide the funding to ship it to, I think, one of the only large format laboratories that can do digitization, which was in Los Angeles. You might know better than, yeah. And so we had to ship them. They were absolutely huge. But then the other terrifying story about Earth is Man's Home is, some of you in Montreal may know, I think his name is, I can't remember what his last name is. He's like a projector builder, and he works a lot with the museums in Montreal when there's kind of specialty construction of projectors for artists' installations. Does anybody know? His name is Robert something. So I was with André Habib from University of Montreal, and he asked me if I would come along with him and Caroline Martel to visit the projection kind of studio where Robert something, I feel terrible, I can't remember his last name, was. And then he was just demonstrating to us this large 70-millimeter projector. And he just picks up some film off the floor and starts projecting, putting it through the projector. And I'm like, oh my God, that's Earth is Man's Home. Like, what is that doing on the floor, you know, as a sampling of something? So it was just a screening copy that somehow he had acquired and was just kind of surviving there. Anyway, there's tons of stories like that. So it's completely unsystematic. It's terrifying once you get into it.
And indeed, the
Robert Miniacci. My apologies to Robert Miniacci. He's done a lot of the projector construction of probably installations that you might have seen in Montreal. Anyway, so I'll end it there. Do you have any archive stories? No, Jordan.
Well,
have you seen Transition 3D?
See, that's the thing, is I've only seen it on video, you know, video on a computer, on a laptop, right. You know, in a very substandard way, you know, compared to how it's meant to be consumed. But yeah, and I don't know, I can't remember the name of the author. I think it's Kaufman, and I think the book is called Ant-Man, and it's a recent novel about a film historian who's trying to track down this fragment of film, and it's sort of a bit of a parody, and I feel like sometimes being in a bit of you know, a kind of you know, this quest for something that you can never get your hands on is sort of experience within working in these media art, media histories. But I mean, I'm not a IMAX historian. I'm really coming at the World's Fair from a kind of a bleak angle of media installations that were going on around the fair, but also on site. And I'm particularly interested in Michael Snow's installation that was in the fair in Vancouver at the time, and some other select works. But the Canada Pavilion, just as I kind of lifted the lid on it, it just became this giant, you know, can of worms. But trying to track down those films, IMAX or otherwise, has been a real challenge. Absolutely. And this is the irony with World's Fairs, is they're on the one hand sort of, you know, the world village, this sort of bringing together of international communities together. But then there's this slingshot effect of everything sort of then getting sort of ejected back to their home countries and other national archives. And they become this real puzzle as a, sort of to try to put it together and try to understand it afterwards.
And indeed, that's another factor, is that because so many of these films were basically the copyright ownership and the, you know, who sponsored what kind of thing means that indeed there's no central archive of where all the IMAX films live. And also Monica mentioning the piece of film sitting on the floor, the size of the prints is another problematic factor, right? Because, you know, an 8mm film can sit in a corner somewhere and remain undiscovered until ta-da. But there's people have a lot of incentive to throw away the thing that's 200 pounds and taking up a lot of space in their closet. So yeah, lots of challenges on that front. But I will say that Chip's work in terms of creating these sort of digital reconstructions of spaces is a really exciting part of this project, because that allows us to, you know, at least get a sense of some of these, you know, spatial qualities that are, you know, present a whole other level of difficulty and complexity when it comes to preservation and, you know, trying to imagine what these experiences were like. So,
thank you very much. I was afraid no one would have an opinion. I was wrong.
There's someone at the back.
I just want to start with saying that I used to work for Stephen Lowe, which is son of Colleen Lowe.
Yeah.
And I have been to the basement at the offices. And yes, there's films there. So yeah, you could definitely find archive. The big problem is that it's humongous.
Yeah.
And then it's very hard. But my question is more to do about IMAX theaters have been changing their vibe, let's call it, going from everything that you have talked about, which is like experimental and funded by the government with some weird corporations. But now if you go to the IMAX theater, which we'll go later tonight, you see what they're displaying is movies that are made more by Disney and they're more corporate or more about mainstream. How has that changed the fact that you have all these buildings that are very geared towards that IMAX documentary creativity? Like, how are the theaters changing? How are the spaces changing to accommodate less of the weird films, let's call it, and more about mainstream? What have you seen in the research?
I hate to do this, but I would love to hear Oliver Hussein, who's done a bit of work on the Golden Snail Cinema in Jakarta. And to me, and you have that, Oliver, in your film, the different kinds of programming at these historic IMAX cinemas. Sorry.
Yeah, although that doesn't really
I think that's another time period, right? Like the golden snails. So I'll be on the next panel. I'll talk about it again. that is a destination cinema that was built for a specific series of films on Indonesia, propaganda films by the Suharto regime, and nowadays shows IMAX films like Alien, Underwater, Space Travel, you know, those IMAX films. But not the most recent Hollywood productions, because the film is, the theater is not digitized yet. So it's kind of stuck in the latest generation of celluloid IMAX.
Well, one thing that is an interesting, I guess, characteristic of contemporary exhibition in IMAX facilities is, so for one thing, now there's a whole range of projection systems that have the IMAX brand name, but have, you know, different screen shapes and sizes and, you know, different varieties of digital projector and so on and so forth. One thing that has happened is cinemas that retain either film projection or the kind of old school screen size, which is, I would say it's not so much widescreen as tall screen. Those cinemas have become kind of destinations in themselves. So the most recent example of this is with Oppenheimer this summer. And it was a whole thing to, you know, find a cinema that still has film projection in order to see that film. And, you know, you would see cinemas having, you know, months long runs with practically every show sold out because it was being shown on IMAX film, or in some cases the sort of laser projection that would have the kind of full aspect ratio. And so there's been an interesting shift in terms of thinking about the technological specificity of those spaces that tends to have more to do with, you know, what kind of machine is in the projection booth. But again, I mean, that draws upon these interesting things about IMAX's longer history of being conscious of the fact that, you know, this is a very specific set of technologies that is giving you this experience. Now, you know, some of those theaters are architecturally interesting, some aren't, that varies. But I mean, that's one set of things that's going on in terms of the contemporary film going context.
Yeah, it's a super interesting question that you're asking, because I mean, as Jenyon said at the beginning, she continually tells us that and encourages us that the IMAX is the future of cinema. And I think in some ways your question makes me recall when Graham Ferguson used to tell us that, you know, from working on Expo 67 films and his Polar Life, which was the 11 screens and his was the turntable, where it was a, you know, 14 minute film that you would circulate in front of. You know, I always remember him saying the transition from that and Labyrinth and all those experiments to IMAX was trying to make a commercially viable format that was able to capture this immersive experience that was so spectacular and at it, you know, with the Expo 67 format. And so I think possibly one of the benefits of so many commercial films being produced in IMAX that we're seeing now is that there's going to be the proliferation of more technology, and the future life of the technology itself is going to make it more accessible to possible experimentation. And I think we'll be hearing from the artists that worked in the IMAX format about, you know, the restrictions of having to work with the cameras. And I'm fascinated to hear about it more. But some of my colleagues that are film historians have also talked about, like, how did the kind of amazing experiments, even starting in the 1900s, make us end up with these cinemas where all of us are facing in the same direction, looking at this little screen, as opposed to these kind of amazing experiments that we see that are unique. But so maybe the future, you know, the future of IMAX is that it makes the experience unique and can be a contrast to some, you know, the other tiny screens that a lot of people are starting to look at, or not starting to, are looking at film and television now. So it just makes much more varied types of unique experience, of which IMAX is the theatrical, spectacular experience.
There's someone has a question on Zoom. Patrizio, are you able to
unmute? Hello?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Good.
Yes.
First of all, thanks so much. Amazing presentations. And I want to build off on this last question, because I've been thinking about how Hollywood films, especially fiction, has used the IMAX format, but hasn't really made dedicated IMAX films. Like when you think of Oppenheimer, you think of Nope by Jordan Peele, there are these vignettes. There's these moments that are the full aspect ratio, the squarish aspect ratio of what you associate with IMAX, which for that immersion, rather than just making the image large, which is what in many cases happens in these IMAX presentations. And I'm wondering if what factors you might sort of suggest that leads to this sort of paucity of like a fiction film and typical narrative being done in that larger aspect. Is there something inherent in the immersion? Is there something going on that an aspect ratio kind of does that? Or are there these larger sort of processes of production, money, or other things?
Thank you for that question. One factor is financial and practical, in the sense that IMAX film is expensive. It is, cameras have become smaller and they've developed, you know, steady cam rigs and things like that, but it is harder to get them places. I mean, it's just big technology. So that's part of it. And so there can be, sometimes it's just strategic decisions on that kind of practical level. Personally, I always perceive these films that, you know, go back and forth in terms of screen shape as in a way a testament to some of the original conceptions around IMAX, which was the idea of having Jordan mentioned Colin Lowe's interest in Eisenstein, and there are archival documents where they talk about the dynamic square and, you know, the sort of possibilities of having an image that changes size and shape. And certainly, I mean, you mentioned Nope. There are, Jordan Peele is very strategic in terms of which sequences are in IMAX. And so when you see it in a theater that is big enough to demonstrate those shifts, I think it's part of the text of the film and what it has to say about spectacle and about media and about all kinds of things that are actually supported by the shifts in aspect ratio. This is a long way of saying it depends, but, you know, some of these are creative decisions, some are financial decisions, and so forth. Other folks might have other takes on that.
Yeah. Well, in relation to Lowe, I mean, he does talk about in the transitions, like it was curious to see him go from Labyrinth to, I don't know what he was sort of peripherally involved in Osaka. Yeah. And then move in Vancouver in 86 to this, you know, singular sort of cinematic single screen piece where you're not actually moving through a kind of spatialized sort of network of experiences, but seated in this, and I think he, from what I recall, he talks about that need for that scale, just to be able to to get that level of immersion that he was after. And so that struck me as somebody who has been studying the history of a kind of more spatialized forms of projected image installation, multi-channel works, to see him move towards a sort of singular seated experience in an IMAX theater.
Yeah, I don't have that much to add to what's already been said, but the Jordan Peele film Nope has a kind of fantasy of IMAX inside it, where, you know, the cinematographer kind of takes off and he has this camera that's an IMAX camera that's been adapted from an Arri camera that's got this kind of flexibility, and he can go out into the field and handhold everything. And, you know, IMAX cameras are changing, especially the digital cameras. We use some of them to shoot the films in outer worlds, but they are cumbersome. They're not that easy to work with. And my understanding, at least in Dunkirk, Christopher Nolan's Dunkirk, is that it was a huge feat to get the IMAX cameras into planes and move them that way, but they're not that easy to work with. So there may be, you know, decisions made just based on the ease of shooting a particular scene. But it's a great question, Patrizio.
Just to add one little thing, and I'm thinking of Chip's prompt in the Osaka Pavilion to think about the smell of the vinyl, you know, the kind of way in which the inflatable itself creates a kind of destabilizing effect. So to think about the IMAX theater itself in terms of its atmospherics as well, you're in a unique kind of space and kind of maxed out in terms of your visibility, but I'm thinking of Nope also in the way that it uses sound and builds that sound right into the narrative as well, so that you have the kind of alien creature that begins to come from behind you. So there's something about the kind of space that gets created in an IMAX theater as well that I think has a certain uniqueness that can permeate potentially narratives themselves and beyond the kind of just the visual register.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Hi, Patrizio.
Do we have any other questions in the audience or anyone online? Very good.
I have a question. I have a question for Chip. I wonder if you could talk to us a bit about the work you're doing on reconstructing the Osaka installation.
So with the Osaka fair, the really big initial challenge is we didn't have the film in hand, Tiger Child. We knew it existed out there somewhere, so we weren't too worried about that, but we didn't have it in hand. And there were all these references to the slideshow that is concurrent with the IMAX film, which in the only sources we had that reference it just sort of said, well, the slides have been lost because of the specific custom technology that was necessary to make it work in the first place. They just deteriorated over the decades since. And then the building itself, unlike many expo pavilions that do get second lives after a fair, the pavilion for Tiger Child was inflatable. And so it's very possible those enormous vinyl tubes are in a warehouse somewhere. But we also don't have that architecture. So a large part of what I've been working on is going through archival material, but also popularly available material. Souvenir guides has been a surprisingly fertile ground for finding information. And using all of this to sort of look at architectural drawings that aren't super well labeled, and then cross-reference that with a photo someone took of the inside of the building and go, okay, so that's what that rectangle on the drawing is. It's referencing a motor that's located here or something. And turning that into a 3D space, I'm digitally modeling the architecture of it, at least from the turntable up. We know that there was a whole floor below the turntable that had an inflatable washroom structure and a cafe. I have found precisely two photos, both of them poor lighting of the cafe, and no sense of how it really relates to anything else down there. So that has been the side of figuring out this architecture and how it all fits together in the space. And then the mandala slides, initially we thought were going to be fairly restricted in their scope, but the further we dug into it, the more we realized it was effectively a 360 dome projection, because it really does cover virtually the whole ceiling on the interior of the pavilion. And there were a few pictures of the slides which can be found through a quick Google search, but I started picking away at it, doing some Google searches, first in English and then in Japanese. And then that led me to the souvenir guides and pamphlets and press releases and newspaper articles. And each of them will have like one photo of the slides to tell their audience, look at this cool slide thing. And luckily they all seem to have taken pictures of different slides. So bit by bit, source by source, we're piecing together all of the slides referenced in Colin Lowe's notes, because we have his script for how they're supposed to be sequenced. And it'll just be a few words that will say electronic devices or children's drawings. And you sort of get used to seeing those descriptors, and then eventually you look in a souvenir guide and, oh, that's what he meant by numbers. And it's just a giant like set of numbers projected onto the ceiling. So the work for reconstructing that really has to do with a combination of photo bashing and digital painting to create, as best we can, accurate interpretations of those images. Because extracting the slide information from a photo of them into something that we can reproject in a digital space is its own challenge. So it's really a lot of different angles and a lot of different tools that we're using to bring this together in a playable environment. I just showed a clip, but what we're actually working towards is an interactive, as I say, VR experience where you can really feel yourself in the space and see how your perspective is changing because of the turntable. I think that answers that.
Yeah, just a little add-on to that too, is that recently in the last month or so, there was a architects collective named Bare Soul, B-A-R-E-S-E-O-U-L, from Seoul, Korea, that reached out to Jeannine and I, and they were in Montreal recently. And it turns out that a lot of the work that they do is actually inflatables. They do contemporary work in inflatable architectures. And they were here in Montreal because they wanted to see the former Korea Pavilion at Expo 67, which is right across from the Parc Jean Drapeau, for any of you that know the Jean Drapeau Island. And so they're actively working now. And they said that a big inspiration for their inflatables is actually Osaka 70. Wow. and that Fuji Pavilion. So we were lucky that to be able to meet up with them about a couple of weeks ago.
Great. You have a question?
Thank you. There are tremendously interesting presentations. I really appreciate it. I wonder if you could, anyone on the panel or all of the panel, a thing that disturbs me about IMAX and in general, but lots of other things like biennales and stuff like that, is the ideology of the spectacle and the kind of tainted history of the spectacle as an ideological tool. And it seems that IMAX is investing so much in large-scale immersive technology, which is, you know, a particular experience. But it's also associated, particularly in the presentations, with a kind of nationalism that I find, you know, a little bit worrying in my world, which is essentially the art world. I find the same problem with the explosion of biennales across the globe as well. So I wonder if you might talk a little bit just about the ideology of spectacle as it impacts your research.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for that question. Yeah, definitely. I mean, that, you know, beginning with our work on Expo, you know, we came to understand, oh, yes, this is a nation building project, and architecture is right now about expressing each nation's vision of itself. And Buckminster Fuller is a perfect example of that, because as much as it's planetary, it's a planetary architecture. It's also a very, you know, American kind, you know, yeah, so it's an American ideology that is driving it. But that's our starting point really for this IMAX research project is to try to understand how this large scale image is this kind of manifestation of a national sui generis or, you know, or ideology. And certainly it's more visible in some of them than in others. Certainly the golden snail in Jakarta was specifically set up as an ideological tool. But all of them, to some degree, la Géode, you know, there's a great story that Jessica uncovered where they didn't want to have IMAX. Because Canadian, they wanted a French invention which exists but wasn't as good, and they ended up going with the Canadian invention. But it is absolutely about the spectacle of nationhood. What's interesting, though, is when there's tension, pushback, and I think we're going to find that with La Bola in Tijuana, which was initially set up as a tourist attraction for Americans. And the first year was about that being connected to the San Diego IMAX. And then there was a huge shift whereby it was, you know, pulled back by the architects and some of the artists involved in making the films to make it about Mexico. So it was a kind of anti-colonial sense. There was a sense that this architecture could express a very different sense of the nation. But you're absolutely right that it is all about an image of the nation. It is all about spectacle. We're excited by the women who are making IMAX films, and Tony Myers and Phyllis Ferguson were very involved in these space films. And I think we're trying to understand what, you know, what does it mean in relationship to gender, these images of space. So we are in the belly of the beast. I think what, and I'll finish here. What drove me personally was that IMAX hasn't really been taken seriously. It's sort of like a genre. It's the IMAX film. And I think looking at the distinct differences between how the IMAX experience is being interpreted in different national contexts, hopefully will yield fruitful results, but thank you.
Yeah, something that's interesting from our perspective with the Osaka Pavilion is that it being so early in the development of the format, you still see a lot of the discursivity to it in the way it's designed, but it's far less triumphant, I guess you could say, than a lot of the later either nationalistic or what you might see in a science center that tends to be very focused on natural phenomena. The way that it uses the screen to juxtapose images, a lot of contemporary commentary mentions that it's a little bit unsettling and it's hard to know what to make of it, because it will take some of that late mid-century enthusiasm about modernity and juxtapose it with images of thalidomide children, images of the Ku Klux Klan, and in a way that doesn't even have a clear statement about it because there's no narration. So you're just sort of presented with the totality of humanity all at once, in literal juxtaposition. And that does leave a really unsettling, that has an unsettling effect because it isn't as explicitly discursive about what you should think about these images. It just sort of presents you with these images larger than life, and you're left to make heads or tails of it.
Picking up on Chip's comment about the Tiger Child film, I think in many ways that film is offering a critique of World's Fair filmmaking and the way that it so often has this, you know, both blatantly nationalistic and, you know, technological progress is the greatest thing ever, right? Like that's central to its ideology. So, for example, there's a moment involving in this case, a triptych, right? So three images, where it starts out with, you know, a pretty girl dancing. And there's a whole tradition in World's Fairs of basically World's Fair is a place for girl watching, right? And so it when you see the image, it plays up this kind of, you know, objectification of this woman. It's also tying in with sort of youth culture stuff, that kind of thing. And then it's placed in a triptych with images from a slaughterhouse, which quite immediately, right, speaks to the not even undertone, but the violence, right, that comes with that kind of objectification. It's specifically a kind of mechanized slaughterhouse, right? And there's multiple moments in the film that provide these kind of shocks to what you would expect from World's Fair filmmaking. Many decades later, you know, we keep coming back to Jordan Peele's Nope, but that's a film that is a very pointed critique about spectacle. And I think that the fact that an IMAX camera plays a role in that film is very significant. Anyway, pick you up on that. Did you have a thought?
I could, but I'm just, time-wise, how are we doing?
We've got five more minutes. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, there's a lot to say about in terms of Vancouver's World's Fair and spectacle. I mean, there's only been a couple really full texts published about Expo 86, and a lot of the art community artists rejected and protested the World's Fair for a whole variety of reasons. In part, this aspect of spectacle, the corporate sort of nature of it, and but also the politics of the governments that were instituting it and moving it forward. But also because in some respects they weren't invited to participate, or they were invited and then they were actually not invited in 1984 due to budget cuts. So this was a time of neoliberalism, corporate expansion. But what I'm interested in relation to the transitions film, because I kind of come at this from more offsite, outside of the fair, and these artists responding to this spectacle initially and really getting into thinking about Lowe and Ionzilla's film, in that it was also trying to react against the spectacle of like Hollywood blockbuster films, like RoboCop was 1986, Top Gun was 1986, these major films, and the multiplex cineplexes and the sort of this other sort of cinematic sort of proliferation that was going on across the country. So, well, yes, it's so heavily loaded, not just the Canada Pavilion in general, that's the way it was curated, with a deliberate sort of ecstatic nationalism, which I find in many respects kind of unsettling. But I think you have to think about Lowe's film and the transitions film in relation to this other these Hollywood blockbuster films, act culture, and also Lowe talks about the fact that it's also I don't have the phrase, but he's also saying like video culture, and I think you probably include a lot of video art, which I'm more excited about, in many respects, is that garbage. He refers to it as garbage. You know, this is a response. Like, we need to get serious and create a new form of cinema. Like, this was supposed to react against that sort of spectacular culture of commercial video advertising, billboards, and other things. So I think it was a response in certain respects to spectacle.
And any final thoughts in our last 3 minutes?
Just come to the next panel because, yes. Yeah, that's IMAX by artists. And, you know, definitely the artists who produced the IMAX films and Monroe Ferguson are they're taking the medium in a very different direction. So,
all right. Great. Well, thank you, everyone, for being here.
Okay, thanks all for coming into Force Space today for this discussion and for all your questions also. We'll be ending our live stream now for everyone online, but we'll keep the Zoom open. If you're sticking around for the second part, which you should, of course, all of you. But yes, so just please join us again at 3 p.m. for discussion with Janine, with the artists and filmmakers from the Outer Worlds Project. And we'll see you all soon. Thank you.